Hey there, amazing audience who have joined the Revolving Time today. Get ready to embark on an unforgettable adventure with us. Subscribe now and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together. Today, we're diving into a topic that's tough, but one that each and every one of us might encounter on our journey, dealing with deceit and betrayal. Well, my friends, today's story is published by Farmer Jill. Wife of 13 years cheated on me with boss, so I teamed up with AP's wife to destroy them. Full story. Well, let's start the story and see how. Her insecurities had cost her everything. My name is Dave Barker and I am sad to say that today is the day my marriage to Claire Hughes ends. It started out with so much promise, our story. 14 years ago, I worked for a company that distributed pumps and motors. We were the biggest company in the tri-state area. We don't build the pumps and motors though, we distribute them for the big manufacturers. The company does really well and part of the reason for their success is me and my team. You see, the CEO, Gary Powers, believed that if they had a mechanical engineer on staff, with a machinist or two, it would really make the company better. I'm the engineer. He was right. Our job was to test the new style pumps and motors that the manufacturers were trying to sell us. We also had the job of diagnosing the problems with the existing lines. Our first success was almost the end of us. This company out of Germany was touting a new supper pump for industrial waste applications. The company had a great reputation and was selling these new pumps as fast as they could build them. We already did business with them and asked for a couple of samples. The Germans were glad to supply them, but wanted an exclusive deal for North America. We had a week to make a decision or they were looking elsewhere. Me and my team had been around for about 6 months at this point and had had some successes. For example, there was a valve problem with one of our popular pumps that occurred only in certain circumstances, and we had solved that with a valve modification. That was both cheap and easy to do. Gary was very happy to date, and then he dropped this new pump bomb on us. Logically, the pump really should have been a no-brainer. The company was German. They certainly know how to engineer things and had a proven track record. We should just go through the motions studying the pump and then sign the deal, get the exclusive, and double our annual sales of pumps. Yet Gary Powers was no dummy. He had worked his way up from nothing and would know if we didn't try, and not trying hard enough was the cardinal sin at our company. Mistakes from hard work were acceptable, but not slacking off. Mistakes from not being thorough enough were cause for termination. We had three samples to test. One spent 7 days running through sludge, thick and full of debris. We threw all kinds of climate conditions at it, desert heat and dust, cold and snow, as well as rain and wet. The other one we tried everything. Dust, dirt, chemicals, you name it. The pump seemed to not like sand, and sand coupled with sludge messed with one of the components. I won't bore you with the engineering details, but it didn't give me and the team a warm and fuzzy, so we told Gary not to buy it. However, we had tested two other new pumps at the same time and the one from an Italian company showed more promise. We recommended that one. For the next 6 months, the sales department hated us. Sales of the Italian pumps were uninspiring, but the German pumps we had rejected were selling like hotcakes. Then the report started to come in. First from the Southwest, about pump failures. Long story short, the company that signed the deal with Germans almost ended up bankrupt with the recalls, repairs, and bad publicity. Our Italian pump sales took off and the sales department took my team out to supper. Update: the worst part of my job was working with our advertiser. Gary believed that I should go listen when our ad company was pitching some new ad idea. He didn't want us to be embarrassed by an ad that promised too much or was technically unrealistic. This made sense. But it still was hard to take so much bull SHT at one time. The only saving grace was the man I usually worked with, Jeff Behrens. He was a pleasure to work with, a real professional. Still, I just didn't like the ad business, but you have to do what you have to do. This was the case until the time Jeff brought someone else with him who was taking over our account. He was getting promoted and Claire Hughes would be our new ad rep. When she walked into our conference room, I was stunned. She literally took my breath away. Claire was on the right side of average in looks, not hard to look at certainly, but she just seemed to me to be what I needed in my life. Somehow I made it through the meeting without making a fool of myself, although I don't remember anything that was said. I spent most of the time just looking at her and trying to come up with a way to ask her out. I think Jeff recognized my problem and made sure he handed me her business card and told me to contact her with any more feedback on the ad presentation. I waited until the next day and called her at work. She seemed surprised to hear from me but agreed to a date. We dated for 6 months before she was convinced I really liked her. She couldn't understand why a guy like me wanted to be with her. This was my introduction to her insecurities. I was just the male equivalent of her, above average but nothing special. Yet she thought she was out of my league and was afraid of getting hurt. Before we slept together, she wanted assurance that I was not going to ditch her right after. Claire wanted an exclusive relationship, and somehow I had to back up my words with proof to allay her fears. The fact that I was already exclusive with her were just words. There was only one thing I could think of, so I surprised her with an engagement ring and she said yes. This must have been the proof she was looking for. We had plenty of great love in the next year before our wedding. Life was good. We both worked hard, and soon enough we were talking about having children. That's when her insecurities started getting the best of her again. It all exploded at our work Christmas party that year. My team tended to stick together at these events, so when our new administrative assistant arrived, Claire freaked out. I will be the first to admit Roxanne is a total babe, but she also has a very good-looking husband. Most importantly to me, she was good at her job, and that helped our team immensely. We got to work and she did the paperwork. However, Claire only saw an affair waiting to happen, and the tension was palpable. When we left the party, she launched on me before the car door I had opened for her closed. I took my time walking around to my door, but she didn't stop until we were home and in our bedroom. She stopped her rant at that point, and I calmly asked her what I needed to do to make her trust me. She said she didn't know, but there would be no kids until she figured it out. I then suggested that didn't mean we couldn't practice. I could show her how much I loved her. She was just too worked up, so she deferred until the morning. It is really weird to me that a woman who thinks you might cheat on her refuses to have love with you for that reason. Oh well, I just took advantage in the morning and we stayed in bed until noon. Exactly 2 weeks and 2 days later, I found out she had her answer when she presented me with the post-nuptial agreement. Yes, insecurity will do that. It covered every possible aspect of custody, child support, alimony, and our house. Not that we had a house. It is pretty hard to spell out exact dollar amounts, but there were plenty of formulas based on percentages of future incomes and the like. The lawyer who reviewed it for me said it was fine enough. As a matter of fact, if Claire cheated, I would be in an excellent position with sole custody and child support. Further to the post-nup, there would be a locator app on each of our phones, and passwords to our phones and laptops were to be shared. Random testing was to be allowed at any time. Obviously, I signed the post-nup and agreed to the phone and laptop IDs. I had no intentions of cheating on her or deserting her. I loved the woman, and after 3 years we had Leslie and the twins Max and Mark. Claire went back to work each time as fast as she could so she could continue her climb up the corporate ladder. It should be no surprise that she was very insecure about her position and advancement, but she did have the kids, and I am very glad. I better be, because I was expected to be the primary caregiver. We never discussed it, but she loved her job and wanted to advance. I had already made my peace with being number two to her job. I did, however, check her phone and laptop for any unusual activity. As well, I always looked at our locator app to see where she was when she worked late. I must admit I was a little suspicious she might try to advance at work by screwing her way to the top. This was certainly not the case. Her boss, Jeff, told me at one social function that my wife had the nickname Madam Serious. It was better than Ice Queen or BTCH, but meant pretty much the same. She was work, work, work. She had no friends at work, she did not flirt, and she was laser-focused on being the best. People respected her work ethic but were turned off by her cold demeanor. Guys especially picked up on her vibe, and unless they worked for or with her, they avoided her. There were plenty of more willing women at the company. Then came the second explosion of insecurity in our marriage. Claire right from the start wanted separate finances. One joint account that we contributed 50-50 to for the household bills, and the rest was none of the other person's business. If I wanted to take her out, I paid. Vacations were 50-50, but as time went on, she never wanted to go on vacations. She might not be number one on the list for the next promotion if she wasn't always there. While the kids were really young, this wasn't much of a problem. But as they got older, it would become an issue. However, first the second explosion, and then we can talk about vacations. Update 1. I wanted to start my own pump and motor company. I had a few ideas I had been working on in my shop at home, and I wanted to run with it. First, I tried to get Gary interested in starting manufacturing. Gary, whom I loved working for, I found out was going to retire and his son was going to take over. Andrew Power did not like our team at all. He had been wined and dined enough by our suppliers to want to get rid of us. We asked too many questions and rejected too many new models, so we had to go. His father, Gary, and I had a heart-to-heart when I came to him about starting to make our own product. I figured he would jump at the idea, but instead, by the end of our conversation, he told me I should take my team and start out on my own. He would give us a guaranteed 3-year exclusive contract to keep doing what we're doing to help us get established. He was going to retire in 3 years, and he knew his son wanted to access. We would be on our own one way or the other. Maybe we could even sell them pumps and motors, but that would be up to Andrew. What an amazing opportunity. and I couldn't wait to go home and tell Claire. That did not go well. This is an understatement. How could I do this to her? How could we pay for our house? We had a mortgage now. She was emphatic that she would not support me or bail me out. What she was really telling me that I was, she was very insecure my idea would fail and leave us destitute. I had to make my monthly payment, or else. Or what else, you might be wondering. It didn't take long for me to find out. Post NUP number 2 or the addendum to the first one showed up exactly 1 week later. Our marriage agreement on money was now to be set in stone. Her money in any form was to be untouchable to me. In turn, my money and my new business was untouchable to her. The joint bank account payment was to be paid each month, no excuses, medical or otherwise. Basically, she was sure my business would fail, and I would go back to secure employment. If I couldn't meet my obligations, I could go bankrupt as far as she was concerned, and I would be out until I could meet my obligations. Claire had refused to listen to anything about my guaranteed contract or the patents I was taking out for my ideas. She wanted financial security, period. I obviously was not very happy with the lack of support from Claire and the post-nup part 2, but as you can imagine, my lawyer could not believe she would sign it. He and the other lawyers at his firm knew my business plan and figured I would be a millionaire by 35. If anything went wrong and we divorced for any reason, she wouldn't get a thing. Except, of course, what the post-nup part 1 laid out. So I signed it despite her lack of faith in me, but I loved her and I wasn't worried about money or infidelity. You could say I was feeling pretty secure. My business took off, and soon enough we were building pumps and motors and had 50 employees. Roxanne was still with me and was my COO. I couldn't have juggled the startup and my children's requirements without her. Don't get me wrong, I loved their sports and school events, but she helped me pull it off. Claire, of course, had been promoted again and spent more and more time at work. There was a problem, though: we never took family vacations. Claire didn't take days off at all. She figured if she missed a day, she might miss something and get in trouble, or worse, get a poor performance view. Yes, I thought maybe there was more to it and kept an eye on her and even hired a PI for a week, but all she did was work. The PI even gave me a discount because Claire did nothing but work and come home. Vacations up until then consisted of me and the kids. We went camping, to the lake, the beach, the mountains, and to my parents, who lived one state over. Claire stayed at work, I mean at home. It came to a head, however, when Leslie, Mark, and Max asked to go to Disneyland. They asked me and I said sure, it was a good idea. They were getting that age when they could really have fun there. Leslie was 9 and the twins were 7. They wanted to know when we could go and if Mom would come with us. I said we could go on their school's spring break, but they would have to ask their mom. I immediately sent Claire a text warning her what was coming when she came home. Claire was a workaholic, but she almost always made it home for supper. She would try her best to engage everyone and then would clean up the dishes with the kids as I usually made supper. I went to work early and left at 4 so I could be home with the kids and make supper. Then usually she took her laptop and went back to work on our sofa or at the kitchen table, depending on where I was. After the kids went to bed, we were not too long to follow. We have love quite often, maybe 2 or 3 times a week, with Sunday usually being the best one. That night Claire came home from work and the kids were all over her about Disneyland. She was not very happy. She put them off with all kinds of excuses, but it was all a smokescreen, for she didn't want to leave work for a week. That night I told her that I would really like her to come, I would pay for it all, and if not, we would go without her. She was a little put out about me paying for it all, so I quickly agreed to pay half if she came. After 2 days of the kids pestering her about it, I arbitrarily gave her a week to make up her mind, supposedly because of a seat sale for the flight. She reluctantly agreed. Leslie, Mark, Max, and I were really happy. We were happy, at least until we arrived on the Monday of spring break and decided to take it easy and go to the beach. Claire said she was just going to check something and catch up to us. We never saw her until we went back to our hotel for supper. Then on Tuesday it was off to Universal Studios, and Claire begged off that too. After everyone was asleep that night, I booked Claire a ticket home. When she woke up the next morning, the 4 of us were getting ready to go to Disneyland. The kids were very excited and Claire was not. She explained to us that she just needed the morning and would join us after lunch. That is when I gave her the ticket and told her she should just go home, back to work. She was pretty upset, and I said we are supposed to be on a holiday and she could make up her mind, work or us. We were leaving in 5 minutes with or without her. She went with us, and she had fun, but never again would she take a holiday with us. Life went on and my company grew to 150 employees. I never spoke about it to Claire, though. She thought she made more money than I did, and this made her feel good about herself. Claire called my company, my pump and motor shop, giving the impression it was tiny storefront repair shop or something. If I started talking about my company and our millions of dollars in sales, I figured this would make her insecure. Claire seemed to be quite secure right now with me and her home life, and that was good enough for me. She was not, however, secure at work. There was four people ahead of her at work, and she wanted there to be only one. The owner, CEO Albert Morris, was a position unobtainable to her, but there were three VP positions she could aspire to, one in particular she coveted. There was the VP of Administration, the VP of Operations, and the VP of Creative. Claire wanted to be VP Creative so bad she could taste it. However, the current holder of that position, Jeff Behrens, was still pretty young and had been her mentor and patron in her rise in the company. She would settle for one of the other positions and doubled down, working hard to understand everything they were doing. The VP of Operations was an old hand at the company who respected Claire and figured she would get Jeff's position when he retired. The VP of Administration was new. His name was Charles Chuck Adams. He was relatively new to the company and figured he could crack the code of Madame Sirius. She was a babe as far as he was concerned, and since he loved a challenge, he was going to take a serious run at betting her. He knew she wanted the promotion, and this fact would be the fulcrum for which his seduction would be based. Claire should know that Albert Morris would be making the decision with little input from the other VPs. However, he also knew she was insecure and he could work this angle for all it was worth. It was late in November when Albert told the other VPs that Jeff would be retiring, but not to say anything yet as he wanted to announce it at the Christmas party in December. Chuck immediately started to work on Claire. He made sure when he saw her next, he casually mentioned her great work and how she should be a VP. For the rest of the time before the Christmas party, he made sure he hinted or made subtle innuendos that the other VPs had input into promotions. He also made a point of telling Claire that fresh blood was needed at the company, so the next VP would probably come from outside of the firm, like himself. Chuck's plan was certainly working. Claire was in a state. She knew deep down that Albert would make the call if and when there was an opening in the VP positions. She also knew that if Jeff retired, he would recommend her. He had told her so, and after five other promotions, she trusted Jeff. Yet she couldn't shake the growing doubt in her mind that her hard work would not be enough. It made sense that the next VP could come from outside, like Chuck. Claire, of course, did not know what was coming at the Christmas party, but was certainly more vulnerable to Chuck's plan by that time. Those insecurities kept popping up in her mind. Chapter 2. Dave was not looking forward to Claire's Christmas party at all. Every year it was the same thing. Claire was the organizer, MC, and general supervisor of the party. This role and her usual business first approach meant that Dave would be on his own for the evening. She would seat him at dinner next to boring men, while she sat with the most important clients who were always invited. She would then spend the rest of the evening working in one way or the other, and he would stand at the bar and have a drink with Jeff. When some new hire woman, or a long-serving one whom didn't like Madame Sirius, asked him to dance, he would politely refuse. Once he had made the mistake of dancing with another woman and that had not gone well, then they would go home late and she would be really tired. This year Dave had had enough, and as they drove to the party he had a short conversation with Claire. "Listen, Claire, I am tired of the same thing every year at your Christmas party," he said. She replied, "What do you mean?" "It is simple. I am not going to spend another party bored and lonely if you ignore me the whole night and won't even give me one dance. I am leaving early." She was so preoccupied with all the details of the party and her role in it that she simply agreed with what he said, effectively blowing him off. Dave knew he would be going home early, and that's what happened. He did have a very interesting and disturbing discussion with Jeff though before he left. Of course, after dinner and the traditional CEO speech, the party was abuzz with the news of Jeff's retirement in the coming year. Dave asked Jeff about it and learned some very interesting information. First of all, Jeff was 60 and he and his wife wanted to travel. They had plenty of money and wanted to enjoy it before they couldn't. Then came the interesting part. Jeff believed that Claire might do something stupid to try and secure the promotion to his position. He had heard Chuck speaking with her and cultivating doubt in Claire's mind that her amazing hard work, skills, and experience would not be enough. Jeff knew all about Claire's single-minded devotion to work and her insecurities firsthand. Claire had even told him about the Disneyland trip and how it caused her so much internal conflict she couldn't do it again. Dave also learned at that time about Claire's work nickname. He knew from his checking up on her and the fact that in all these years she had done nothing suspicious that she was all about work. However, he didn't know about the Madame Sirius moniker and how many men she had actually shut down, both co-workers and clients. It was disturbing to know that apparently this Chuck guy was going to take a run at his wife. Moreover, it didn't help that Claire seemed to be preoccupied with talking with one person in particular this night. Sure, she was busy doing her run-the-party thing, but she kept coming back to one particular man. Younger than Claire and Dave and clearly good-looking, this guy clearly knew it. Dave asked Jeff who it was and was not surprised to learn it was Chuck, the VP of Administration, the very person he was warning Dave about. It was getting close to 10 p.m. and Dave had enough to drink, which wasn't much, and had refused a couple of dances. He decided it was time to go, but he would give Claire a chance and started to walk in her direction. As he approached her and Chuck, Claire noticed he was coming and did not want him to interrupt their discussion. She was working on Chuck about information on how to get the VP position, and he was talking freely. Claire knew that Dave wanted to dance with her, but she was busy with work. So she made eye contact with Dave and then promptly turned her back on him. Dave was no dummy and took the insult for what it was. He turned around and left. Claire didn't notice for obvious reasons and was too preoccupied for the rest of the night to even miss him. It was only at 1 p.m. when the party was about to break up that she noticed Dave wasn't there. She asked Jeff, who was still there, if he had seen Dave and was not happy with his response. "He told me that if you didn't dance with him, he was leaving. He told me that he had told you this, and when you didn't dance with him, he left." Claire was embarrassed but did remember vaguely that Dave had said something like this, but at the same time was mad because he was not supporting her work. She was working on Chuck and her promotion. How could he do this to her? Her anger built as she had to wait for a taxi to take her home. By the time she came through the door, she had worked up quite the head of steam. Storming into the bedroom, she woke up Dave with a very loud, "How could you just leave? I was so embarrassed that you left me there without even saying goodbye. You say you support my work but left me hanging when I needed that support. How could you?" At this point, Dave was awake and had had enough. "Listen, I warned you, Claire, that if you ignored me all night, I would leave. One dance is all I wanted. How do you think I feel that you literally turned your back on me for the company of another man?" This stung Claire, not just the tone, which was unusual for Dave, but the insinuation that she was interested in another man over him. Dave continued, "I can't dance with anyone but you, and you won't dance with me. I respect that and don't even look at the women you work with, but for you to then be more interested in Chuck than me is too much. I have supported you on the home front, and in every way I can think of. I am proud of your success at work and have told you many times and done whatever you have asked. However, sometimes I get a little frustrated that we don't have vacations together and work is clearly number one in your life. Now I am going back to sleep." Update: Claire left the room and went downstairs to think about what Dave had said. After much time and reflection, she realized that Dave was right and she would change. She first just had to get that VP promotion, and then she could relax a bit and concentrate more on Dave and the kids. By the time she reached this conclusion, it was almost 7 a.m., so she joined Dave in bed. Claire also made sure he had an enjoyable morning by waking him up with some serious loving. She made sure that she was home quite a bit at Christmas, at least quite a bit for her, and tried to have quality time with her husband and kids. Then New Year's was over and it was back to serious work. Now that the news was out in the open, Chuck ramped up his campaign on Claire. Albert had announced that they were accepting applications and interviews would start in February. They hoped to have the new VP in place for April. Jeff asked Claire if she was applying, and her response was to give him the completed application form and an updated CV. Jeff tried his best to explain that Albert would make the decision and that Jeff supported her candidacy. However, as much as he tried, he could tell Claire was very insecure about her chances. Chuck, of course, was the main cause of these insecurities. Dave's parents' wedding anniversary was on February 10th, and Dave and the kids usually went to visit for the weekend to celebrate with them. Claire had not come in the last 11 years, so it was no surprise to Dave that she was not coming this time. His parents lived 4 hours away across the state line, so they usually left right after school on Friday and returned Sunday afternoon. Dave once again asked Claire to go, but she told him she couldn't get away due to a big meeting with a client that Friday. Chuck continued his maneuvering on Claire. He started in on the sexual innuendos and ramped up the flirting. Claire was getting more and more anxious every day. She would be the first to appear at the receptionist's desk when the mail arrived. She would try to subtly ask Sherry in HR about how many applications had come in. Sherry worked directly for Chuck, and he made sure to inflate the number of outside applications and their qualifications. Sherry then passed this on to Claire, unknowingly helping in her seduction. Since Chuck was spending so much time at work around Claire, he ended up finding out on Monday that Dave was leaving with his kids for the upcoming weekend. Conveniently, his own wife, Doris, was going to visit her twin brother Mike the same weekend. Mike and his wife lived about an hour away, and Claire always followed the same routine. She left Friday afternoon and stayed the night, returning Saturday evening. Mike and Doris were close like only twins can be, and this happened usually every other month. Chuck couldn't believe his good fortune. Update 1. After the full court press all week, Chuck made sure Friday morning he told Sherry about a star candidate for the position of VP who had just submitted her resume. After Chuck was sure Sherry had talked to Claire, he made his move. He entered her office at 4 o'clock and inquired what Claire was doing for supper. I'm just going to go home when I'm done and have some leftovers, she replied. Well, why don't we go out and grab a bite to eat? We then could really work on a strategy for you to get the promotion you deserve so much. Claire thought about it. Dave and the kids were gone, and she had to eat anyway. Sure, how about we leave at 6? She replied to Chuck. Chuck was elated. I will book us a table at a good restaurant. See you in the parking lot at 6. Claire spent the next 2 hours unable to work. She couldn't stop thinking about all of the candidates for the coveted VP position, and how she could she possibly make sure she was the one to get it. By the time it was almost 6 p.m. she was stressed right out. Then she received a text from her husband Dave. I hope the big meeting went well. Any plans for the night? Claire thought about her reply. She did not want to lie, but at the same time she couldn't tell him that she was going out with Chuck. She replied, the meeting was a success, going out for drinks to celebrate with some people from work. Dave was surprised by this unusual behavior from Madam Sirius. He replied, have a good time, miss you. Claire was surprised at how easy the lie had come, but she rationalized, this was the big promotion, so it was all for a good cause. Dave would be proud of her. Dave figured that Claire would be heading across the street from her office for drinks at Dino's bar. He decided to check his locator app at 6:30 and noticed she was not at that bar but instead at D'Angelo's, an upscale restaurant. He could not believe it. Had she lied to him? Claire and Dave had been to D'Angelo's a few times, but he couldn't remember if it had a bar or not. He continued to check the locator app. Around 9, the app showed that Claire was now at the Skylab, the hottest club in the city. Dave didn't want to get too paranoid. It could all be explained by the fact Claire needed dinner, so they had gone out for food first and then drinks. It still was unusual behavior for Claire, so when his parents and children went to bed, he logged onto the Skycam. The Skycam was the Skylab's catchy gimmick that had made it the most popular club in the city. Claire had created it as part of a marketing campaign. Located above the DJ, the Skycam showed part of the dance floor directly in front of the DJ. The camera slowly panned back and forth. Privacy concerns had been addressed by notice at the entrance of the club and a sign on the DJ booth. Local celebrities were encouraged to make sure they were seen on the Skycam that of course streamed live. The Skylab have also obviously had a highlight reel of the top celebrity that had been at the club. It was a very popular feature, and yet it only covered about one quarter of the dance floor, so it was easy for people not to be in its line of sight. Dave had been watching for about 15 minutes when, much to his chagrin, his wife and no other than Chuck danced by. Dave took a deep breath and tried to relax. It was all very explainable. Yet Dave started to record what he was watching. The group from work included Chuck, and they were just having some innocent fun. He continued to watch and looked very closely to see other people from Claire's work. Dave did not see anyone he recognized until yet again he saw Claire dancing with Chuck. However, this time it was a slow song and they were dancing much too close for Dave's comfort. Chuck was all over her, and she was not resisting at all. Actually, she seemed to be giving just as good as she got. When the song ended, Claire and Chuck were still in focus on the edge of the camera's line of sight. It was still very clear to Dave that they now were kissing. Dave then went into his photo gallery and found the emergency contact list from Claire's work that he had taken a picture of. He dialed the number of Doris, Chuck's wife. She answered on the third ring. Hello, is this Doris Adams? Yes, it is. How did you get thing number? She replied. It is Dave Baker. I am the husband of Claire Hughes, who works with your husband Chuck. I am calling because right now your husband and my wife are at the Skylab and doing things that will not pass the spouse test. Dave heard an intake of breath and Doris replied, that bast. I gave him a second chance and this is what he does to me. What are you planning on doing? Dave was quick to explain. I plan on divorcing her, of course. It's a long story and I won't bore you with the details, but there is no other option. There is a problem though. I am tracking her with our locator app so I know when they will go back to my house or a hotel, but I am 4 hours away and can't make it back to catch them in the act. Doris made Dave very happy with her response. I am not home tonight, so they might also be going to my house. Listen, I am only 1 hour away with my brother Mike, who I might add to test Chuck. We can leave now, and by the time we get back to town you can tell us where they are and we can surprise them. Dave was very happy. Sounds like a plan. I will send you the recording of their antics at the Skylab and I would appreciate you sending me whatever you can from surprising them. Doris affirmed they were on their way and Dave continued to watch the Skycam and his locator app. Half an hour later, Claire was on the move. She was headed to a residence that wasn't Dave's, so it must be the Adams house. Dave texted Doris the information. Meanwhile, Claire was feeling no pain and really hot. Alcohol and handsome men did that to her. She couldn't wait to get into bed with Chuck and seal the deal that would guarantee her the promotion. There were no thoughts of consequences, only results, and she was desperate for results. An hour later, Claire awoke from her act. She was still pretty drunk, but the realization hit her that she had cheated on Dave. Yes, it was for a good reason, but it still was cheating. She figured she better get home. Chuck, however, also came around at that time and wanted round two. Claire succumbed to his persuasions, and when Doris and Mike arrived, she was dot dot. Mike made sure he had plenty of video of the lovers, and then Doris acted. The next thing Claire knew, someone had a hold of her hair and was pulling her off Chuck, smack. That same someone dot Claire hard to the face and then backhanded her. Unfortunately for Claire, the backhand was done with Doris's ring finger, and her wedding ring opened up a gash on Claire's cheek. "Get the duck out of my house, you whore," yelled Doris as she dragged Claire off Chuck towards the door. Claire shook herself loose, grabbed her clothes, and ran for her life. Doris turned back to see what Mike was doing to her husband. Chuck was doubled over in pain on the floor beside the bed, and Mike was busy kicking him in the groin. Claire dressed in her car and then went to the emergency room at the hospital. She ended up with 3 stitches. The gash was too big for the glue or tape. She drove home and dragged herself to the bedroom, crying the whole way. How could she explain the gash on her cheek to Dave? Would Doris tell Dave what happened? How could she have done such a stupid thing? With these questions playing over in her mind, she fell asleep. Final update. Meanwhile, Dave was busy. After receiving the video from Doris, he had work to do. First was an email to his lawyer asking him to forward the following information to his firm's best divorce lawyer. The attachments included both prenups, the sky cam footage, and the footage from Doris. He also attached his log of all of the events that Claire had missed for the children, just in case she decided to fight custody. There was no way, after all the insecurity bullshit he had been through, that divorce was not the only option. Next, he sent a text to Claire explaining him and the kids would be home Monday instead of Sunday. This would allow Dave to change the locks on the house and hopefully have her served at work that day. He didn't have to worry about moving any money, as it already was very separate. Claire woke up with a hangover, and she thought she had had a bad dream until she touched her cheek and realized it was not a dream, it was a nightmare. Looking at her phone, she read the text from Dave. She now had more time to figure out her story. She didn't know whether to contact Chuck or not. He solved that problem by showing up at her house after lunch on Saturday. "Chuck, what are you doing here?" she asked. "I am not welcome anymore in my home, so I came here," Chuck replied. "Well, you can't stay. What will the neighbors say?" Then she quickly added, "Do you think Doris will tell my Dave?" "I'm pretty sure she already has. I heard Mike and her talking after they were tired to kicking me and I passed out. As a matter of fact, I think Dave was the one who told Doris." Then it hit Claire, the locator app she had insisted on. Dave must have used it to find her, then told Doris. Claire had an overwhelming sense of dread come over her and slammed the door in Chuck's face. Monday morning arrived and Claire went to work. What else could she do? She used makeup to minimize the damage to her cheek and went into work. Everything was relatively normal until 1 p.m. when a young man she didn't recognize arrived at her office door. "Are you Claire Hughes?" he asked. "Yes, I am," Claire replied. "You have been served," he said and handed her an envelope. He took a picture and left. Claire and her world collapsed. Meanwhile, Dave was busy changing the locks on his house. He had explained what was going to happen when he drove the kids home from his parents. He knew that school was not an option this day, so they were in their rooms pondering their parents' marriage demise. Claire finally worked up the courage to phone Dave. Dave answered on the second ring. "Yes, Claire." "Dave, I have made a horrible mistake and I need to talk to you about it," she replied. "You are certainly right about the mistake. After all of the post-nups, 13 years, 3 kids and all of my love, you made a terminal mistake. You killed our marriage. This is the last time I will be speaking to you until the divorce is final. I will be enforcing all of the terms of the prenups, and if you fight me, I will bury you. Just sign the divorce, then you can hang out full time with your true love and not have to worry about us interfering with your work anymore." And after that, Dave hung up. Claire broke down in a puddle of tears, her life a ruin. Her insecurities had cost her everything. The end. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. So take care of yourself and see you soon with another story.